Macmillan Audio presents Love People, Use Things, written and read by Joshua Fields Millburn and Ryan Nicodemus.
Preface. Pandemic preparation. The streets are a rumpant with uniformed men wielding titanic assault rifles. Through their megaphones, they command us to lock our doors and stay in our homes. Overhead, military helicopters blare Stayin' Alive by the Bee Gees from their intercoms, the soundtrack to our new dystopian future. Bang! Bang! Two gunshots in rapid succession. I jolt awake and find my wife in bed next to me and our daughter in her room, both asleep. Walk into the living room, retract the window shade, look out at my neighborhood, Los Angeles, midnight, empty boulevards, light rain beneath arc lamps, no sign of martial law, only a stalled pickup at the bottom of the hill. I let out a deep sigh, just a nightmare, fortunately. But the world in which I awoke, the so-called real world, is markedly different from the one I'd experienced the first 4 decades of my life. Not necessarily post-apocalyptic, but not normal either. Serpentine lines slithering through grocery store checkout aisles, boarded windows concealing hollowed-out Rodeo Drive storefronts, devastating silence blanketing empty movie theaters galvanized by dust and darkness. Crowds separated at 6-foot intervals being herded into bare-shelved food banks. Anxious families coping with being alone together while sheltering in place. Hospitals splitting open with overworked nurses and doctors whose apoplectic expressions are hidden only by their own homemade face masks. As I finished writing the final chapter of this book in the spring of 2020, the COVID-19 pandemic was seizing the globe. Our new normal feels grossly abnormal. With the twin terrors of financial and physical uncertainty, an undercurrent of angst continues to pulse through our days. But perhaps there's a way to find calm, and even to prosper, in the middle of the chaos. I didn't know it at the onset of this project, but while quarantined in my home during the pandemic, I realized Ryan Nicodemus, the other half of the Minimalists, and I had spent the last 2 years writing not just a relationship book, but, in many ways, a pandemic preparation manual. If only we could have gotten this book into the hands of struggling people before the spread of the virus, we would have prevented a great deal of heartache, because intentional living is the best form of preparation. When you step back, it's easy to see that the so-called preppers, the embarrassment of hoarders we see on our TV screens, are the least prepared for a crisis. You can't trade canned corn and ammunition for the support and trust of a loving community. You can survive, however, if you need less. And you can thrive, even in a crisis, if your relationships are thriving. Pandemic has a sneaky way of putting things in perspective. It took a catastrophe for many people to understand that an economy predicated on exponential growth isn't a healthy economy. It's a vulnerable one. If an economy collapses when people buy only their essentials, then it was never as muscular as we pretended. The minimalist movement described in this book first gained popularity online in the aftermath of the 2008 crash. People were yearning for a solution to their newly discovered problem of debt and overconsumption. Alas, over the past dozen years, we've once again grown too comfortable. But the enemy isn't only consumerism now. It's decadence and distraction, both material and not. Amid the panic of the pandemic, I noticed many folks grappling with the question Ryan and I have been attempting to answer for more than a decade. What is essential? Of course, the answer is highly individual. Too often, we conflate essential items with both non-essential items and junk. We delineate these three categories, essential, non-essential, and junk, with our no-junk rule in the relationship with stuff chapter. In an emergency, not only must we jettison the junk, but many of us are forced to temporarily deprive ourselves of non-essentials. Those things that add value to our lives during regular times but aren't necessary during an emergency. If we can do this, we can discover what is truly essential, and then we can eventually reintroduce the non-essentials slowly, in a way that enhances and augments our lives but doesn't clutter them with junk. To complicate matters, essential changes as we change. What was essential 5 years ago, or even 5 days ago, may not be essential now. And so we must continually question, adjust, let go. This is especially true during a crisis where a week feels like a month, a lifetime. Stuck in their homes, people wrestled with the fact that their material possessions matter less than they originally thought. The truth was all around them. All the things collecting dust, their high school baseball trophies, dusty college textbooks, and broken food processors were never as important as people. The pandemic magnified this reality and demonstrated a crucial lesson. Our things tend to get in the way of what's truly essential, our relationships. Human connection is missing from our lives, and it can't be purchased. It can only be cultivated. To do so, we must simplify, which starts with the stuff and then extends to every aspect of our lives. This book was written to help regular people like you and me deal with the external clutter before looking inward and addressing the mental, emotional, psychological, spiritual, financial, creative, technological, and relational clutter that weighs us down and disrupts our connection with others. If you have followed The Minimalist for any time at all, you will recognize bits and pieces of our story in the Introduction to Living with Less chapter, death, divorce, a packing party. But these elements aren't only for new readers. In this book, we take a deeper dive into the struggles, insecurities, substance abuse, addiction, infidelity, zealotry, heartache, and pain that were the catalyst for lasting change in our lives. Then, once those details are on the table, we explore new territory as we navigate the seven essential relationships that make us who we are. This isn't a book written for a pandemic. It's a guidebook for everyday life. The pandemic has simply heightened our everyday problems and rendered them even more urgent. With the most recent financial downturn and a renewed search for meaning, our society will be coping with some critical realities in the not-too-distant future. Many new norms have been established. Others will continue to form as we move forward. Some of us will attempt to cling to the past, to return to normal. But that's like struggling to hold a block of ice in our hands. Once it melts, it's gone. I've been asked, when is this going to turn around? But turning around presupposes that we should return to the past, to a normal that wasn't working for most people, at least not in any meaningful way. While I don't know what the future holds, I know we can emerge from this uncertainty with a new normal, one that is predicated on intentionality and community rather than consumer confidence. To get there, we must simplify again. We must clear the clutter to find the path forward. We must find a deeper understanding beyond the horizon. In the thick of the coronavirus crisis, I had a conversation with one of my personal mentors, a businessman named Carl Widener, who showed me the characters for the Chinese word for crisis, wei ji, which signify danger, wei, and opportunity, G, respectively. While there are arguments among linguists as to whether the character for G actually means opportunity, the analogy is still apt. A crisis exists at the intersection of danger and opportunity. In time, there will undoubtedly be more crises. Even now, as I record this, a heightened sense of danger lingers in the atmosphere. But opportunity is also in the air. Surrounded by danger, we have a chance to, as my friend Joshua Becker says, use these days to reevaluate everything. Maybe this was our wake-up call. Let us not waste this opportunity to reevaluate everything, to let go, to start anew. The best time to simplify was a decade ago. The second best time is now. An introduction to living with less. Our material possessions are a physical manifestation of our internal lives. Take a look around. Angst, distress, restlessness, all visible right there in our homes. The average American household contains more than 300,000 items. With all that stuff, you'd think we'd be beside ourselves with joy. Yet study after study shows the opposite. We're anxious, overwhelmed, and miserable. Unhappier than ever, we pacify ourselves with even more accumulation, ignoring the real cost of our consumption. The price tag dangling from each new widget tells only a fraction of the story. The true cost of a thing extends well beyond its price. There's the cost of storing the thing, maintaining the thing, cleaning the thing, watering the thing, charging the thing, accessorizing the thing, refueling the thing, changing the oil in the thing, replacing the batteries in the thing, fixing the thing, repainting the thing, taking care of the thing, protecting the thing, and of course, when it's all said and done, replacing the thing. Not to mention the emotional and psychological cost of our things, which are even more difficult to quantify. When you add it all up, the actual cost of owning a thing is immeasurable. So we better choose carefully what things we bring into our lives because we can't afford every thing. Seriously, we can't afford it. Literally and figuratively. But instead of delaying gratification and temporarily going without, we go into debt. The average American carries approximately 3 credit cards in their wallet. 1 in 10 of us has more than 10 active credit cards, and the average credit card debt is more than $16,000. It gets worse. Even before the pandemic of 2020, more than 80% of us were in debt, with the total consumer debt in the United States greater than $14 trillion. Now, there are at least a few plausible, albeit regrettable, explanations. We spend more on shoes, jewelry, and watches than on higher education. Our ever-expanding homes, which have more than doubled in size over the last 50 years, contain more televisions than people. Every American, on average, throws away 81 pounds of clothing each year, even though 95% of it could be reused or recycled. And our communities are peppered with more shopping malls than high schools. Speaking of high schools, did you know that 93% of teens rank shopping as their favorite pastime? Is shopping a pastime? It seems so, since we spend $1.2 trillion every year on non-essential goods. Just to be clear, that means we spend over $1 trillion a year on things we don't need. Do you know how long it takes to spend $1 trillion? If you went out and spent $1 every single second, $1, $2, $3, it would take you more than 95,000 years to spend $1 trillion. In fact, if you spent $1 million every single day since the birth of the Buddha, you still wouldn't have spent $1 trillion by now. With all this spending, is it any surprise that roughly half the households in the United States don't save any money at all? As it happens, over 50% of us don't have enough money on hand to cover even a month of lost income. 62% of us don't have $1,000 in savings, and nearly half of us couldn't scrape together $400 during an emergency. This isn't merely an income problem. It's a spending problem that affects low-income folks as well as six-figure earners. Nearly 25% of households earning between $100,000 and $150,000 a year say they'd have a difficult time coming up with an extra $2,000 within a month. All this debt is especially frightening because 60% of households will experience a financial shock event within the next 12 months. This was all true even before the economic downturn of 2020. That crisis simply illuminated how thinly stretched we are. And yet, we keep on spending, consuming, growing. The size of the average new home is rapidly approaching 3,000 square feet. Yet with all that extra space, we still have more than 52,000 storage facilities across the country. That's more than four times the number of Starbucks. Even with our bigger houses and our storage units teeming with stuff, we still don't have enough room to park our cars in our garages because those garages are brimming with stuff too. Unused sporting goods, exercise equipment, camping gear, magazines, DVDs, compact discs, old clothes and electronics and furniture, boxes and bins stretched from floor to ceiling, stuffed with discarded things. And don't forget about the kids' toys. Despite making up just over 3% of the world's population of children, American kids consume 40% of the world's toys. Did you know the average child owns more than 200 toys but plays with only 12 of those toys each day? And yet, a recent study has shown what parents already know. Children who have too many toys are more easily distracted and don't enjoy quality playtime. As adults, we have our own toys that distract us, don't we? Unquestionably. If the entire world consumed like Americans, we would need nearly five Earths to sustain our unchecked consumption. The popular maxim, "the things we own end up owning us," seems truer now than ever. But it doesn't have to be this way. Existential clutter. There are many things that once brought joy to our lives but no longer serve a purpose in today's world. Rotary phones, floppy disks, disposable cameras, cassette tapes, fax machines, laser disc players, pagers, Palm Pilots, Chia Pets, the Furby. Most of us cling to our artifacts well into their obsolescence, often out of a pious sense of nostalgia. The hallmarks of the past have a strange way of leaving claw marks on the present. So, we hold a death grip on our VHS collections, our unused flip phones, our oversized Bugle Boy jeans, not repairing or recycling these items, but storing them with the rest of our untouched hoard. As our collections grow, our basements, closets, and attics become purgatories of stuff, overflowing with unemployed miscellanea. So many of our things have fallen into disuse, and maybe this lack of use is the final sign that we need to let go. You see, as our needs, desires, and technologies change, so does the world around us. The objects that add value to our lives today may not add value tomorrow, which means we must be willing to let go of everything, even the tools that serve a purpose today. Because if we let go, we can find temporary new homes for our neglected belongings and allow them to serve a purpose in someone else's life instead of collecting dust in our homegrown mausoleums. On a long enough timeline, everything becomes obsolete. 100 years from now, the world will be filled with new humans, and they will have long abandoned their USB cables, iPhones, and flat-screen televisions, letting go of the past to make room for the future. This means we must be careful with the new material possessions we bring into our lives today. And we must be equally careful when those things become obsolete, because a willingness to let go is one of life's most mature virtues. Let's explore how we got here and how we can let go. Excessful. How might your life be better with less? The simple life starts with this question. Unfortunately, it took me 30 years to ask this question. I was born in Dayton, Ohio, the birthplace of aviation, funk music, and 100-spoke gold rims. More recently, You may have seen the news that Dayton is the overdose capital of America. It's strange in retrospect, but I didn't realize we were poor when I was growing up.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.